Today we are starting our next chapter, geomorphic process, right? So next chapter is geomorphic processes. Students, till now you have learned how our earth is originated. What is earthquakes? What are volcanoes? How they work? What type of landforms built by the volcanic eruptions? Right, there are some exogenic processes, some endogenic processes, all that, right? So how the plates move, all that we have already learned. In this chapter we will deal with the geomorphic processes. Geomorphic processes, first of all, what do you mean by geomorphic? Geo means earth and morphic means change, right? So the process which cause the changes over the surface of the earth, in the surface of the earth, that is called geomorphic processes, right? So geomorphic processes, what is geomorphic processes? Exogenic, endogenic processes, diastrophism, volcanism, weathering, types of weathering, mechanical expansion, unloading, expansion, temperature changes, expansion, freezing, thawing, frost, wedging, salts, weathering, chemical weathering, biological weathering, all we will learn in this chapter, right? Because all these things cause the geomorphic process that bring the changes within the surface of the earth. Right, so biological activity and weathering, special effects of weathering, significance of weathering, what is the significance of weathering, what is mass movement, slow movement, what are rapid movements, and what is landslide, which type of features are formed by these movements, what is erosional work, depositional work, and what are the forces behind these erosional, transportation and depositional work, how the soil is formed, what is the process of soil formation, what are the soil forming factors, what is the parent material, topography, climate, biological activity, time, etc. We will discuss all these things in this chapter. Right, so it is a lengthy chapter but very interesting, right? Students, first of all, the question is why our earth is uneven. You can see on the surface of the earth there is a mountain, some regions are carried with plateaus, some are occupied with plain areas, some have rugged mountain terrains, right? Some have oceans, right? So our earth is uneven. It is not flat, it is not even, right? Why earth is uneven? What is the cause behind it? Due to internal and external forces, earth is changing its surface condition. It means this is due to internal and external forces. Now, what are these internal and external forces? We will discuss it later on in this chapter, one by one, how they work. Basically, the uneven surface of the earth is a cause of some internal as well as some external forces. Our earth crust is not static, it is always dynamic. In the previous chapter, you already learned that our earth is a dynamic, right? It is not stable. In the continental drift theory, you learned that our continents are still moving, ocean floor is still spreading. So it shows that our earth crust is dynamic and it moves vertically as well as horizontally, right? If it moves vertically and horizontally, no doubt our earth crust will be changed according to their movement, right? So that's why our earth is uneven. Now, what is gradation? Why these vertical and horizontal movement took place. The difference in the internal forces making the surface uneven. Wearing down of relief feature is called gradation. Gradation means when some internal forces makes the surface uneven and wearing down the relief. Like when the earthquake comes, suppose this is our surface of the earth. When the earthquake comes, or this surface will goes down, right? So this relief will lower down. So this is known as gradation. When the relief is going down, wearing down, right? Due to the differences in the internal forces. So that is called gradation, right? So wearing down the surface or the relief features is known as gradation, right? The endogenic forces always elevate parts of the earth's surface, and hence the processes fail to even out the relief variations on the surface of the earth. Now you must know the what are the endogenic forces and what are the exogenic forces. Endogenic means in, right? Means the forces which works inside the earth. Correct. And what type of forces works inside the earth? Yes, I told you that the earthquake and volcanoes, right? Earthquakes and it's plate movement, right? Plate movement and earthquakes works inside the earth. When the earthquake comes, some part of the earth can be uplifted. That is called mountains. Like plate movements. When the plate moves, the different continents, different reliefs were built, right? So similarly, exogenic forces are those forces which works over the surface of the earth, right? That works over the surface of the earth. Now, what are these forces? What are the forces which cause exogenic processes? These forces are like sunlight, right? Sunlight, rainfall, wind, underground water, glacier, all these are exogenic forces which cause the exogenic processes. And due to these forces, our relief brings down. Suppose this is a mountain. Continuously, it is striking by the river water. This part will be eroded by the water, and slowly and gradually, and after many years, the some of the elevation bring down. Right, so the exogenic process, due to the exogenic process, the elevation goes down, while endogenic forces always elevate parts, it uplifts the parts. So variation remain as long as there is difference between endogenic and exogenic forces. If there is a difference between endogenic and exogenic forces, there will be a change in the surface of the earth. So our earth is sensitive, and human being is using the surface intensively and extensively. No doubt, in endogenic and exogenic forces are natural forces. We can't stop it. But the most important factor is human being. In the recent past, as we are going, as we are developing, we are interacting with our surface. And due to the human activity, like if we have to make the hilly region, we are cutting down the hills, right? We are de-elevating. So human process is more important and more effective in the surface of the earth. It at the same time, it also causes some destruction over the surface of the earth, because we are changing the surface according to our need. We don't care about the balance of the surface. So to create some So it is very important to make the human activities responsible and in such a manner that our surface keep on balance. Now come to the main factor, that is geomorphic processes. Right? Now, before telling you the geomorphic processes, you must know everything about the endogenic and exogenic processes, because we will again and again we will talk about these endogenic and exogenic processes. As I told you that endogenic processes are those processes which work inside the earth, while the exogenic processes are those processes which works over the surface of the earth, right? Endogenic processes are the building forces. They create some new things over the surface. While endogenic forces are sudden forces. Sudden forces like earthquakes, plate tectonics, volcanic eruptions, all these are called endogenic forces, which create inside the earth, right? And exogenic forces are like sunlight, rainfall, river water, groundwater, glacier, wind, ocean currents. All these forces are applied over the surface of the earth, right? So endogenic forces and by the detailing of endogenic and exogenic forces, you must know that these forces cause physical stress as well as chemical actions on the earth material, and bringing the change in the configuration of the earth surface is called geomorphic processes. Now, what do you mean by geomorphic processes? Due to these two forces, there is some physical stress. Physical stress means the stress which we can see with our naked eyes, right? Suppose if there is a GD road, suppose this is a road, right? And the rainfall is coming. Very high rainfall is falling on the road. What would happen? The particles of the road will be eroded, right? There will be maybe with the continuous process of raining, there could be a pit in the road. That is called physical stress, right? Physical stress, which we can see, correct? Now, the second word is used, chemical actions. Chemical actions, when the water reacts with other chemicals found in the rocks, because rocks are the composition of minerals, right? Suppose when water came into the contact of iron, yeah, or we can say when iron came into the contact of water, what would happen? Continuous contacting of iron with water Suppose, as I told you, the physical process by the river water is falling, it will cut down this part and the water is directly flowing. That is called waterfall, right? So waterfall is due to the physical stress of exogenic processes. Waterfall is a geomorphic process, right? A new thing is built over the surface of the earth, right? So that is geomorphic processes by the endogenic and exogenic forces. If there is a physical stress and the chemical actions on the earth material, and it brings the change in the configuration of the earth surface, that is called geomorphic processes. Now come to the endogenic processes. What are these endogenic processes? We got to learn. Endogenic processes are mainly two, diastereism and volcanism, right? And the endogenic processes, we will study about the diastereism and volcanism, correct? Now, in this chart, you can see the earth movements. As I told you, earth movement is due to two forces, endogenic forces and exogenic forces. Endogenic forces are called sudden forces. Sudden forces like earthquake, volcano and landslides, right? And second type of endogenic forces are diastrophic forces, which are mountains, river, wind, sea waves, and glaciers. Correct? So by all these forces, our landforms evolute. Our landforms evolute, our earth surface got some changes, and that is called geomorphic processes. Now, weathering, mass wasting, erosion and deposition. These are known as exogenic processes, right? Any exogenic element of nature capable of acquiring and transporting earth materials can be called a geomorphic agents. And now, who are these geomorphic agents? All these four, right? Including groundwater also. There are five geomorphic agents which create some erosional work, some depositional work, right? So they are called geomorphic agent, which brings geomorphic changes in the geomorphical changes in the earth, right? And the process done by these agents and the process done by these agents are known as geomorphic processes, right? So the factors which brings geomorphic process, that is called geomorphic agents, and the process by these agents is known as geomorphic processes, right? So geomorphic agents cause weathering, mass wasting, erosional and depositional work. They are also called exogenic forces. Okay, now how they work. We are talking about the geomorphic agents. Five agents we discussed: river, water, sea waves, wind, glacier, and ocean and underground water. Right? How they work? They became mobile when there is gradient. Gradient means slope. Right? Water will flow from high to low slope. Suppose this is a gradient. So when the river is flowing, the river will flow from this gradient, from by this slope. You never seen the river is flowing from bottom to top.
it cannot be happened, right? Remember these two things. Means it will flow along the slope, and this slope is known as gradient. Otherwise, the flat surface, the water will not move. If there is a slight gradient, there is a slight slope, the water will move. So these agents became mobile when there is a gradient, when there is a slope. So running water, moving ice, wind, underground water, and waves are known as erosional agents because they keep on eroding the material on the top of the hills. So they are known as erosional, they do erosional work. Before detailing these things, we are focusing on the some of the terms, right? So a process, what is a process? A process is a force applied on the earth material by the agents which are mobile medium, and they removes the material, they transport it, deposit the material on the flat surface, right? So they actively also causes directional forces activating downslope movements of water, downslope movement of matter, and sea waves and tides are indirect movement of the earth caused by gravitation. Here you can see the these five agents, these five with the gradients, they move with the gradient, right? If there is any gradient, they will move and they will cause the changes over the surface of the earth by the erosional work, by the transportational work, and by the depositional work, right? But there are some forces like waves and tides. They caused due to the indirect movement of the earth. How? Suppose the waves and tides are generated due to the gravitational force of the moon, right? When the move through the gravitational force over the surface of the earth, the tides come. The sea water goes up, rise, and down twice a day due to the gravitational force of the moon. So the tide comes by the indirect movement of the earth, by the gravitational force of the earth. Similarly, sea waves move due to the movement inside the earth. It moves due to the tectonic forces, due to the earthquakes which comes in the oceanic crust, right? So here we see the two things. First is gradient and second is gravity, right? So due to the gradient and due to the gravitational force, these five agents became mobile, right? So all the movements, we can say all the movements on or in the earth are due to gravitation or gradient. Means the material will move from higher level to lower level or higher pressure to low pressure areas. Clear? So geomorphic process is mainly done by two forces, exogenic forces and endogenic forces. When we are talking about the exogenic forces, there are five main agents: river water, glacier, sea waves, underground waters, and wind. Yes, they mobile due to the gradation on the surface of the earth. So the first important thing is gradient. If there is a gradient, that's indirect forces like gravitational force. Due to the gravitational force of the earth and the moon, the tides come, the waves move,
move the ocean currents produce, and so the two things are important for the mobility of geomorphic agents. That is, first is gradient and second is gravitational force, right? So now due to these two factors, geomorphic agents keep on moving and the sun's heat, they become mobile, they resist the energy generating from within the earth is the main force behind the endogenic geomorphic process. What are these energy? These energy generated inside the earth, and they make these endogenic processes possible. What are these energy resources? First is radioactivity within the earth surface, rotational force of the earth, tidal friction, primordial heat. We already learned about it in the chapter number 2. So primordial heat from the origin of the earth, all these four factors gives energy to the endogenic agents. What are endogenic forces? Diastrophism and volcanism, right? So diastrophism and volcanism are due to the geothermal gradients and heat flow going from within the earth. These forces became active due to the thermal difference. Thermal difference means geothermal means geo means earth, thermal means temperature. Where there is a temperature differences, there will be some diastrophism or volcanic activity. Second, heat, which the heat which is flowing within the earth, they also cause diastrophism and volcanism, right? So crustal thickness, strength, action of endogenic forces are due to the variation in geothermal gradients. Because in the third chapter, we learned that the temperature goes higher as we go inside the earth. So there is a temperature differences. When the temperature differences are there, it means that will create the gradients, high to low. Right, when there is a difference in the temperature, there will be geothermal gradients, and these geothermal gradients cause the heat flow uneven, and this diastrophism and volcanism took place. Now the question arises, what is diastrophism? We are talking about diastrophism. What is diastrophism? All processes that move, elevate, or build up portions of the earth's crust come under diastrophism, right? Any process by which our earth is elevating means any portion. Suppose this portion is originally this portion is this, right? By the earthquake or any other activity, volcanic eruption, this elevation goes higher, so that is diastrophism, right? Suppose this is a flat land, an earthquake comes and this area goes higher, so that is building, right? So new things, some portion is building, that is called diastrophism. Now the diastrophism is of two types. First is orogenic processes. Orogenic processes is known as mountain building processes. By these processes, the mountains fill. As I told you that if there is any volcanic eruption, there could be a mountain building, right? By the movement of plate tectonics, in the fourth chapter, you learned that by the plate tectonic movement, there was Himalayan formation because it caused fold in the sea, and the part of that sea goes up higher and took a shape of mountain, which we call Himalayan mountain. So that process is known as orogenic process. It is mountain building process, right? Oro means mountain. So it causes several folding and affecting long and narrow belts of the earth's crust, right? Second is apergogenic processes. Apergogenic processes is known as continental, right? Which affects continent. So apergogenic processes involving uplift or wrapping of large part of the earth's crust. So it is related to the continent. When the forces affect the continents or the rigid part of the earth, that is known as apergogenic processes. Third is earthquakes, right? So earthquakes, what do you mean by earthquakes? When there is some shaking within the earth crust, that is called earthquakes. By the earthquake, our surface got faulting and fracturing due to the earthquake. Some part can be thrust, right? Some part can be rugged by the earthquake movement. The next is plate tectonics. Plate tectonic is involving horizontal movement, because there is seven major plates over the we can divide our earth in seven major plates, and these plates move horizontally, right? So when there is a simple movement within the plates, that is normal. But whenever they move very fastly, tectonic forces, and we can categorize upliftment of landmass vertical forces. These are vertical forces and causes continental formation, while orogenic processes are responsible for the mountain building. The last endogenic forces is volcanism. Volcanism means when the molten magma comes over the surface of the earth, and when it took different shapes. We learned about the intrusive and extrusive forms of volcanism in the last chapter. So there are some intrusive and extrusive forms are created by the volcanic eruptions, right? So they are known as volcanism. These forces work inside the earth and known as endogenic forces, right? So today we have discussed about the endogenic and exogenic forces. What are endogenic and exogenic forces? Endogenic forces which works inside the earth, and exogenic forces which works over the surface of the earth. Exogenic forces derive their energy from the sun, while endogenic forces derive their energy from the rotation of the earth, by the radioactivity and by the primordial heat, right? And exogenic forces causes mass wasting, weathering, erosion and apposition work, while endogenic forces causes diastropism and volcanism. Diastropism included four processes: orogenic, apergogenic, earthquakes and plate tectonic. Clear? So if you have any doubt, you can ask student. If you have any doubt regarding this concept, you can ask. Just raise your hand. Mayank, Supriya, have you understood?